My name is Neelke Doorn, and I work at the Philosophy Group of the University of Technology in Delft. And I did my PhD on responsibility in research teams. In this lecture, I will focus on the conditions for responsibility and the problem of many hands. And after having watched this web lecture, you will be able to describe the conditions for responsibility and apply these to concrete cases, to describe the problem of many hands and explain how it applies to engineering, and three, to describe how engineering design may affect the distribution of responsibility. It is important to distinguish between the responsibility of engineers on the one hand and the responsibility of users of technology on the other. And the first two topics relate to the responsibility of engineers. And I say engineers, but by this I mean all people that contribute to the development of technology or innovation. And the third topic relates to how engineering design may affect the responsibility of users of technology. Let me start with the responsibility of engineers. Engineering often takes place in teams or networks of many people. And before we can discuss the responsibility of those groups, we first have to look a little deeper into what we mean when we say that an individual person is responsible. Well, usually we say that a person is responsible if the following four conditions are met. First, the freedom condition. The person should be free to act and not be under external pressure. So if I put a gun to a person's head and I ask this person to do some nasty thing, this person cannot be held responsible for this nasty thing. He or she was not free to do otherwise. The second condition, that's the knowledge condition. A person should have the knowledge that his action, his or her action, would lead to some negative outcome. And if the person does not know this, he will generally not be held responsible. Say someone painted the door of his house without putting a notification that the door was wet. If I happen to touch the door and thereby destroy the new painting, it is not fair to hold me responsible or to blame me. I did not and could not know that the door had just been painted and that I should thus not touch it. The third condition is the causal connection. There should be some causal connection between the act of the person and the negative outcome. I cannot be held responsible for things I did not causally contribute to. So if someone else touches this recently painted door, it is not fair to hold me responsible. And note that sometimes doing nothing is the wrong act. So if I'm in the possibility to save a person from harm, not doing anything is the wrong act. The last condition is about the transgression of a norm. What I did was somehow faulty. I transgressed a norm. And this norm can be a legal norm, but also be an ethical or a social norm. It is a difficult condition, but especially when we talk about institutions, about legal norms later in the course, it is an important condition. Institutions, legal institutions should be designed in such a way that they represent the right norms. Now, let us look at an example in which several people are involved. This example concerns the hypothetical development and use of some new fire-resistant material. There are four people involved. Person A is working in the laboratory and he's doing fundamental research into the atomic properties of this new material. Person B is hired by the fire brigade to design a new outfit for the firemen with this promising new material. Person C is the director of the fire brigade, who hired the designer, and person D works at the fire brigade and he's responsible for cleaning the fireman's outfit. Now, as it turns out, this promising new material happens to be carcinogenic if it is brought into contact with washing power. One of the employees from the washing department develops a lethal type of cancer and eventually dies. Can we say that one of the persons is morally responsible for the death of the cleaner? Well, let us look at the four people. All persons made some causal contribution, but the other conditions are probably not fulfilled. At least none of the individual people fulfilled all conditions. The person working in the laboratory may have known that this material could have some chemical reactions, with other materials, but he could not foresee how others would use the material. The other persons probably did not know about the carcinogenic properties of this new material. And one may even say that the person responsible for the cleaning was not really free to act differently. So it's the actions of the four people together that lead to some dramatic outcome, but none of the individual persons can be held responsible. And this phenomenon is called the problem of many hands. Because there are many different people involved, it is impossible to identify one single person that is responsible. And this problem is very urgent in engineering because there are often many people involved in the development of technology with potentially high impact if things go wrong. Think of the oil spill of the BP platform in the Mexican Gulf. The impact of this disaster was huge, and it immediately prompted the question, who is responsible for this disaster? Well, the problem of many hands is often discussed in a backward-looking sense, that is, after some negative event has happened. However, we can also use it, we could use the problem of many hands in a forward-looking sense. We can then use the conditions to see whether the persons are able to carry out or fulfill their responsibility. Does the person have the freedom to act? Does he or she have the required knowledge? Are the right norms in place, etc.? And this brings us to the last topic of this lecture, the relation between responsibility and technology. Well, the automatic pilot in an airplane is a clear example of a technology taking over responsibility from a person. But can technology also be developed in such a way that they enable people to assume their responsibility? I think that technology can indeed have this role, but it requires that we pay attention to the specific aspects of responsibility when technology is being developed. Well, I will briefly describe two examples. The first is the V-chip, and the V-chip is a technological device designed to prevent children from watching violent television content. TV stations broadcast the rating as part of the program, and parents program the V-chip by setting a threshold level rating, and all programs above the rating are blocked by the V-chip when it is turned on. Now, some people say, well, by using the V-chip, parents transfer responsibility to the TV stations because they let the TV station decide on the exact rating per program and thereby on the question whether this program will be shown on their television at home or not. And as such, the V-chip seems to limit the freedom of parents. However, other people say, well, the V-chip provides the parents with more information on violent content. And as such, it gives them more freedom to check what their children actually watch. Whether the V-chip limits or enhances the parents' responsibility is open for discussion, but the example clearly shows that technology can and does affect a person's responsibility. The second example, that's a control room. And a control room is a central space where a large, physically dispersed facility or service can be monitored and controlled. These rooms are often equipped with multiple monitors and screens, and people working in a control room often have to make quick decisions on the basis of a huge amount of information. And that means that the layout of these rooms and the way the information is presented determines to what extent people are indeed able to make the correct decisions. We could say that a badly designed control room may hinder people from taking their responsibility. But vice versa, a well-designed control room may enhance a person's ability to carry out his or her responsibility. Okay, well, in this lecture, I have discussed the conditions of individual responsibility and the problem of many hands, and I have shown how technology can enable but also hinder a person in carrying out his or her responsibility. Well, often nowadays we talk about responsible innovation. And responsible innovation, that's technology that's developed in such a way that it may facilitate or strengthen people in their ability to carry out their responsibility. Goodbye, and thank you for your attention.